when you look back historically, because you're a historian of the subject, what's the one event to you that stands out the strongest where you go, you know what, right here, this is an event?
Potentially Starfish Prime, the nuclear test in space.
Really? You're going there?
On Johnston Island, missile preparation for the July launch of the Starfish Prime shot. Starfish Prime was ready. One more answer was needed. How feasible was it to test nuclear weapons in outer space? Here, in still pictures, are two profile views of the Starfish Prime Aurora as seen from the Hawaiian Islands.
Because there was a small group of people on both sides that were trying to do exactly what they did, which was fly swat some bugs out of the sky.
So, Operation Starfish Prime. I can't believe you went there.
And what's up, everybody? How are we doing? My good people. All right, so what's going on? I'm David from the Wild Signal, and today we're going to talk about Operation Starfish Prime and its importance to the whole UFO phenomenon and everything else that's going along. So where I got the story from, where I originally heard it from, was in this Tom DeLonge book. We heard him talking about it before and everything, but in A Fire Within, Chasing Shadows, and there's another one of it in his book, he goes into depth a little bit more about it, and he tells the story through the eyes of Henry Hank Babish. Okay, Hank Babish is an operator on a naval vessel with all kinds of instruments and everything to monitor the EMP effect of Starfish Prime. What is a nuclear blast in outer space going to do? What's going to be the EMP implications, the electromagnetic pulse? How far is it going to shut down stuff? What's it going to do? So they had instrumentation all over the island, just everywhere, staked out all in the Pacific, all over, even on the eastern coast, just everybody trying to see what was going to happen. So they had lots of instruments, lots of things to record this. They were set up. They were ready. They wanted to see what was going to be the implications of exploding a nuclear weapon in outer space. What was going to be the EMP pulse, the electromagnetic pulse? What was going to be the fallout? So this story is told through the eyes of Henry Hank Babish, who is an operator on one of these vessels. And we know that Starfish Prime is true. We know it really happened. You can go look up all these cool videos they have about it. So the story starts here with Henry Hank Babish on Chapter 27, and it starts in the Johnston Islands, July 9th, 1962. So we're going to get to reading a little bit, and I'll bastardize it, start on one page and go to the next. So it goes like this. Naval Space Surveillance System in Dahlgreen, Virginia. Repeat, this is Naval Space Surveillance. And then it goes on to say, "What, sir?" he managed. "It seems like the electromagnetic pulse has done more than stop some satellites from transmitting. Our sensors suggest that one of them is coming down." Now, this is the Naval Space Surveillance in Virginia reporting back to the ship that Henry Hank Babish is on. And it goes on to say, "It wasn't actually on our radar till it began to drop. We don't know where it is. We don't know whose it is. Or we don't know whose it was or what it was doing. To tell you the truth, never had Hank Babish heard a composed military man so clearly out of his depth and off script. We have no idea what the hell it is or was. We just know it's coming down." All right, so this is the Naval Space Surveillance System calling to the ship to let them know, "Hey, we just picked up something on its way down. We have no idea who, when, where, what it is, but we know that after this electromagnetic pulse, it is coming down. It's on its way." So I like the way they put these little stories in here. And this is some true stuff, at least the names and dates. How true this event is, we'll talk about it afterwards and we'll see. But it goes on like this. "Well, the first thing I see," said Babish in his defiance, turning to a baffled curiosity, "is a correlation here between the British Jordale Bank and the Goldstone Deep Space Communication Radio Telescope, which seems to show a transmission originating outside our galaxy immediately after the Starfish Prime EMP. So after the Starfish Prime EMP, the Goldstone Deep Space Communication Radio Telescope picks up a transmission originating outside our galaxy and immediately after the Starfish Prime EMP. So, you know, that's pretty dope. And it goes on to say, did you hear what I just said? A transmission from deep space. Yes, says Skyline, I'm blinking. We've known about them for years. All right, so Skyline, let me introduce his character. Skyline is a older CIA type guy. They describe him as always wearing shades and suits. You know, I don't know if that's the Men in Black element, but they always describe him as wearing shades and suits. And once they knew that something was starting to come down after this electromagnetic pulse, then, hey, Skyline got involved. He got to the ship, and now he's there. And Henry Hank Babish is telling him that, hey, after the electromagnetic pulse and this thing start to fall, we picked up a transmission originating outside our galaxy immediately after the Starfish Prime EMP. And Skyline retorts back, we've known about that for years. And it's like, oh, we're just now starting to hear about, you know, deep signals from space. And we listen here and they're like, we've been knowing about those for years. That's not what we're worried about here. You know, we want to find the actual thing that's dropping. And I like how they describe Skyline here as an elderly CIA man. You know, still wearing suits and shades as if he was part of a DC security tail. Okay, so at this point, they know that something is dropping from space. They know that it sent a signal to deep space and got one returning as it was going down. And now they're trying to find where it's going to fall at. So they've been at sea for a few days now, and they are trying to search the ocean for this. What fell? Is it in parts? Is it crashed? And we'll pick up right here. They have been actively searching the water for 3 hours, and Babish's patience was starting to wear thin as the fading light when a member of the scuba team that had been making a series of dives from the dinghies broke the surface with one hand in the air. Something like glass or metal flashed in it, an L-shaped panel, a little under 2 feet across. Relief broke over the boat like a wave, and suddenly there was a bustle of activity as the crew dropped ladders and swung hoist to get the men to their findings aboard. Babish rushed to join them, but then Skyline was looming over them. So as the divers are looking in the water, they come up with something. They have pieces of a wreckage, something that they thought was going to fall from outer space. They finally found where it was at, and it fell. So now they're holding up L-shaped panel and a little under 2 feet across. So that's pretty cool right there. So I'll describe what it says the metal looked like. It was still speckled, or I'll read what they say it looked like. It was still speckled with beads of seawater, so that for a moment, Babish thought that his strange phosphorescence had something to do with that. But when he patted it dry with the cloth, the curious ripple of color in the metal only seemed to increase. It pulsed with blue-green radiance, as if it was glass backed with foil. Tilting and pivoting in the light, though it was actually lying perfectly still on the worktop. So here we have this metal with this phosphorescent glow over it, with it shimmering in the light, but it's sitting still. So they're describing some of the metals. So after the electromagnetic pulse, something fell into the water. And when they go to recover the metal is mysterious. It looks like nothing they've ever seen. It has a phosphorescent glow to it. All right. And so I'll read a little bit more right here. And it says, sir, what is it, Babish? What do you expect to find? A way to turn a terrier into a wolfhound, says Skyline, almost to himself. Sir, said Babish. They're looking for a way to turn a terrier into a wolfhound. All right. And so later it goes on to describe, as they were looking for more of the metal, a cigar-shaped UFO craft comes over and he's trying to get rid of the metal, or trying to find the metal before they can. And it goes into that. So let's talk about some of the things that we heard here today just now that I just read. And this is from A Fire Within, and the story is by Henry Hank Babish and Starfish Prime. So here we have a nuclear weapon being exploded in outer space, causing an electromagnetic pulse. And the pulse was so strong it knocked out several things and several satellites, but it brought down some unexpected things. or something that was very, very, very unexpected. They got a call from the Deep Space Command that says, hey, we didn't even have this item on our satellite. On our charts. They charted the skies. They know where all the satellite was until this one started to fall. Sent a message back into deep space and received one. There was so much equipment that was, planted that was used in the Starfish Prime event. So much equipment around Johnston Island and around the world to pick up the electromagnetic pulse to measure things, that if this story is true, I do believe that, yeah, they probably did pick up all this stuff. They had all the equipment right there. They had everything they needed. They're getting calls from Naval Space Command saying, hey, something is coming down and all this. And if we know the stories now about the metals that's been associated with all these crashes, you know what I mean? We got Hal Puthoff on Coast to Coast talking about the metals being associated with this crash. We see him, Project Atom. They're sitting there talking about metals. When Henry Hank Babbage described in Tom DeLonge's book, when he goes on to describe the metal as being, 2 feet across and, L-shaped this big. If you guys can remember, Grant Cameron said they had a piece as big as 5 feet. He was even reporting that they had a big piece of metal that they were testing and stuff. So when it comes to the EMP pulse and something dropping and metals being collected, I do believe it. And we know that we do have a crash recovery team. And this is to be the things that our crash recovery teams would be on, something like this, a mysterious metal, a mysterious object falling from space after the electromagnetic pulse. You know what I mean? And when I start hearing about the, Tom DeLonge talking about when we put Operation Starfish Primes, let us know that we could put the boxing gloves on. It lets us know that we could fight back. It makes me seem like, you know what? Nuclear weapons seem to be a good thing in order to fight back from little bugs, as he likes to call them. So if we're sitting there and he's beating that drum, it makes it seem like we're pro-nuclear. We need nuclear weapons to make sure that the little bugs or whatever they say, they did the experiment to see if they can swat some flies down, and they did. So it makes us think that they want us to be pro-nuclear, okay? Pro-nuclear. Go ahead and build more nuclear weapons, and let's keep our stash because they're able to bring these things down. You know, it's a funny thing. I'm drawn to that, but that's what it makes me seem like. Like, if nuclear weapons are helping us bring down little bugs, as he likes to call them, if it's helping up, and that was our way of putting the boxing gloves on to see that we can fight back. If this is our way of doing that, it makes us seem like someone wants us to be pro-nuclear, whether it's for a good cause, like fighting back, or whether they're just duping us. So that way they can have nuclear weapons or whatever. But it seems like when I hear stories of this, is like a success. We blew up a thing in outer space and we brought something down. And you know what? They've been here monitoring us secretly. And we need to put on the boxing gloves and get this done. So therefore, we need nuclear weapons. That's what it seems like to me. I'm not saying whether it's right or wrong. And we know Tom DeLonge is not pulling this story out of his ass. Because if you go and watch one of the Starfish Primes documentaries, it's from Stanford Research Institute. It's called The Phenomenology. And it's by the Stanford Research Institute, by SRI. Who was involved with SRI? Hal Puthoff. Who's on Tom DeLonge's team? Hal Puthoff. So I'm sure when they got this story, since it was researched by all the major players, Los Alamos was there, and EG&E, all the players were there, SRI. So if they investigated this electromagnetic pulse phenomenon and what had happened, and something did come down that was mysterious, and this story was known to them, and Hal Puthoff worked for them, and now he worked for Tom DeLonge, I would like to draw that correlation that he's the one that related it to him. He's the one that related it to him. This is what happened when this happened. And I'm not saying that Hal is pro-nuclear, but this is what happened. And I'm sure I would like to be 100% sure, but we never know. But I would like to think this is where Tom got that story from. Because Hal is involved with SRI, and SRI was involved with some of the monitoring and all this stuff that went on with this. It was a lot of people involved with this. A lot of people. But I find that very interesting. Very, very interesting. You know, Starfish Prime was our attempt. Well, it's not an attempt. We blew up a nuclear bomb in outer space. It caused an electromagnetic pulse. that was wild. I think it was over 950 miles. It just did all kind of things. And if that did bring down something, I'm sure we liked it. So when we hear stories of underground alien bases and them exploding nuclear bombs underground, does that tie into? Does that have something to do with it? Is Phil Schneider and these guys right? Does this have something to do with it? Is this why you would put a nuke underground? To try to explode it and hope that you knock the EMP pulse out of something else? Who knows? Am I just drawing, am I drawing too many lines? Probably, most likely, but it's very interesting. So I just wanted to hit you up with that. Another story from Tom DeLonge's book, A Fire Within. AJ Harvey, those guys put it down. I'd like to thank you for listening. Click like, subscribe, and everyone enjoy. I'm out. Peace.